everybody, and welcome to Author's Voice, a book signing network. I am Libby Hellmann. I am the author of 15 crime thrillers. And today, we are going to be talking about one of the iconic authors in the mystery community, Sara Paretsky, whose new book, I think it's her 20th novel, is called Fallout. And I am so pleased that you are here because although we have talked many times in the past, we've really never talked about writing. So I'm curious and I'm interested to find out what you have to say. I'll tell you just a little bit about Sara. If I read her bio, we'd be here for the whole time reading her achievements. But before there was Lisbeth Salander or Stephanie Plum, there was V.I. Warshawski. Sara Paretsky revolutionized the mystery world in 1982 when she introduced V.I. in Indemnity Only. If you haven't read it, you really need to read it after you read Fallout. By creating a believable investigator with the grit and the smarts and the snark to tackle problems on the mean streets, Paretsky challenged a genre in which women were either vamps or victims. Hailed by critics and readers, Indemnity Only was followed by 19 more best-selling Warshawski novels. The New York Times writes that Paretsky always makes the top of the list when people talk about female operatives, while Publishers Weekly says, among today's PIs, nobody comes close to Warshawski. But there's another side to Sara that we're gonna talk a little bit about today, and that is her passion and her commitment to social equality. And she has spent years talking out when someone needs to talk out and to share the inequality that still exists in our society. So we're going to talk a little bit about writing and a little bit about that. Welcome, Sara.
Great to be here with you, Libby.
Thanks. Okay, let's start with Fallout. Where did the idea come from?
I grew up in eastern Kansas, and my dad was a cell biologist at the University of Kansas.
By the way, I saw you slipped his name into the book.
Yes.
That was very clever.
So he worked on an organism that caused a disease very similar to typhus. And the Russians, in the years after World War II, were trying to weaponize typhus and turn it into a bioweapon. So my dad was very curious about the organism they were working on, and when he finally got a chance to go behind the Iron Curtain in 1964 and go to Czechoslovakia, where one of their biggest bioweapons labs was, he persuaded one of their scientists, I think she fell in love with him during this conference because she showed up at our house in the middle of the night during the 68 crush of the Prague Spring. Anyway, she injected him with their organism, and he got off the plane in Kansas City with a fever of 104, but didn't start antibiotics until his tech had come to take a blood sample so he could culture it. And this story has really haunted me. I don't know why I never asked him about it. It was my last year at home, and home life was pretty tumultuous, and I think it kind of got swallowed in all of the tumult of the house. But I wrote a short story about it for an anthology Jeffrey Deaver did last year called Ice Cold, and it kept haunting me. And so when I decided to try to use at least part of that story as the basis of a novel, I could only imagine it in the Kansas of my childhood. And poor V.I. has to hit the road and go to eastern Kansas and experience not quite the Kansas of my childhood. Many changes, both good and bad, since then.
There, a missile silo that had been built by the Army or the Air Force figures prominently in the story. Was there actually a missile silo?
There were missile silos near our house. We passed them on our way to school. We knew that I lived in the country, and there's a story about that too. But we knew we were expendable. We knew that we were where a direct hit could be made and nobody would regret the people of Douglas County, Kansas being obliterated. Mm. And today, there were something like, I can't remember, thousands of them anyway. I have the numbers my research notes, but I won't bore everyone with my research notes. But anyway, after the disarmament agreements between Reagan and Gorbachev, they started decommissioning these. A lot of them are empty. A lot of them are being used for meth labs. But some of them are being turned into high-end condos for people who think that they want to survive.
I just read about those.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're underground.
Yes, for a couple of million dollars, you can buy a survival condo. It comes with a 5-year supply of dried food. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, they think Wi-Fi will be available after a nuclear war. So Wi-Fi is guaranteed.
And then they have these movies on the, or screens on the wall that, where you can choose whether you want to see a seashore or the mountains.
Exactly.
Or, oh, my goodness.
Granite German countertops in the kitchens. That's all.
Yeah, right. What was it like to write about your hometown after being, after living so many years in Chicago? Did you feel like you were really coming home, or were you more of an outsider than you had thought you would be?
I felt like more of an outsider than I thought I would be. It was also physically hard for me to get myself into that physical location. I mean, or mentally hard for me to move into that physical location. It was very strange. You know, that landscape is so familiar to me and yet so alien in a way as well.
How old were you when you moved away?
I was 19 when I came to Chicago, so I really spent my whole youth there.
Yeah, but you spent more years in Chicago.
More years in Chicago. I still have family in Kansas, though, and I'm back there a lot.
Going back to the subtle reference to David Paretsky. You have a character who is, I'm hoping, the darker side of your dad, Dr. Keel. Was there any connection between the two, or were they totally separate in your mind when you were writing them?
The Dr. Keel was based, yes, on the more negative aspects of my dad's personality. My father was a mercurial man. He had enormous charm, enormous energy. I think probably if we had ever been able to persuade him to get near a psychiatrist, he would have had a strong bipolar diagnosis with paranoid tendencies, because he could become very withdrawn, stop speaking for days at a time. But he was always a really careful and meticulous scientist in the lab.
And you're proud of his accomplishments.
I'm proud of his accomplishments, I guess.
Yeah.
I think that I'm, yeah. Yes, okay. Of course I am.
Of course. In your book, a librarian becomes a hero. And I know you care a lot about the guardians of our literature. Did you know that was going to happen? Or did that just sort of, the plot kind of raised itself and you knew you could do that?
I didn't know that the librarian was going to play such a key role. I always think that when I finish a book, and David Remick from The New Yorker said this once, that you walk away and you think everyone will see the scotch tape and the glue and the places that you put a little epoxy in, hoping no one would notice the holes. So there was a lot of backing and filling. A lot of my writing is throwing out and rewriting and trying again and again and again to get to the place that I need to be. But I love the Lawrence Public Library, and I'm proud of my hometown. It may be the only town in America which these days has actually voted to increase their taxes to support the library, mm-hmm. and overwhelmingly voted.
Wow.
That, I think it was a 70-30 split when the vote came. And so they built a beautiful library. My mother was the children's librarian there for 25 years.
Oh, that explains it. Okay.
And
there's a little more of a connection than I had thought.
But you're absolutely right about librarians. You know, they are really on the front lines of protecting our right to speech. They have come up with very inventive ways to protect our privacy when we use the internet or when we check out books, because the Patriot Act gives the government the ability, the right actually, to come in,
demand all circulation records and all internet use records. And if they send you a national security letter asking for that, you can be imprisoned for an unspecified number of years if you even consult a lawyer for how to respond to the national security letter. So that librarians have just stepped up to the line and started working on our behalf. I think they are such underappreciated heroes. I always think it's the ad that you see when you're thinking about, should I go to medical school, dental school, library school? Library school, they say, you could go to prison. You could make no money. Come.
You know what? Librarians are some of my favorite people because underneath that demure surface, they care. Mm-hmm. They really do care about our privacy. They care about, and you did mention some of that in the story. So, and I appreciate
that. Oh, did I?
You did. Well, let's talk a little bit about it.
What did I say that I forgot?
Well, I'm going to remind you. It was a complicated story. It was a very complicated plot with a lot of characters. How did you keep them straight?
So physically, I work with big artist pads, and I'm not someone who outlines. Outlining for me is like creating a dead book. Mm-hmm. I know there are people who absolutely depend on it.
Jeffrey Deaver does. He writes 100-page outlines.
And so does Elizabeth George.
I can't do that either.
No.
So
it's overdetermined for me if there's an outline. Yeah. But as I get into it and when I really feel I've got the right storyline, then I start making columns on my big artist's pad of the characters, the chapters that they were in, what they're doing in those chapters, and how mm-hmm. their stories need to interconnect. And if they haven't yet, then I have to go back and start doing a little embroidery, a little epoxying.
Yeah. And that's what I was going to ask you is whether you outlined or not, and you answered that. Okay, I want to pose a question because it's something that I struggle with a lot, and I wonder if you do. When you realized that the story was going into radiation and poison and fallout, and then it goes from there, were you at all apprehensive that readers would find it unbelievable? What readers sometimes tell me is that Ellie Forman is, you know, she's a video producer. There is no way she would come into contact with radiation or fallout or poisons mm-hmm. on a normal basis. And I'm wondering whether that has ever come across your mind when you're doing a VI story.
Oh, it constantly. I mean, but I think that there's a way in which all crime fiction, maybe all fiction, involves some suspension of disbelief, and your job writing it is to try to make it credible within the incredible world that you're creating. And I think I do better and worse jobs of that. I'm someone who reads more for character, dialogue, than I am someone who cares so much about plot.
Right.
So I'm willing to cut other writers a lot of slack if they have a really good prose style and their characters are people that I'm engaged by. And I just, so my goal is to write well enough that readers will cut me slack for the stuff that I get wrong or that is incredible.
Did you have to do a lot of research on the different issues that you brought up, particularly the scientific ones, the bioscience?
I totally did. I was very lucky that my dad's last graduate student is still young, hale, and hearty, and was willing, he and his wife, who also is a cell biologist, I thank them in the acknowledgments, that they gave me enormous amounts of help. On the other hand, they also, they really rained on my parade because I wanted to use my dad's organism, Coxiella burnetii. And they said the reason that the Soviets could not weaponize the version of that they worked with is that it just is it's very hard to culture in mass quantities, and it's it has such a short shelf life that it's just not a good bioweapon. And so they made me, kind of bullied me into switching to bubonic plague, which I think is trite.
Yes and no. I mean, I went for it. I mean, I was right there for it. And
but, you
and,
know,
and
everybody
don't
writes about
too many spoilers.
Bubonic plague.
They
like my, the first horror movie that kept me awake at night was one in which rats infect some. It was a Western
right.
where the town.
But,
sorry.
But it works. But it works because, you know, it has been weaponized in the past. Or
yes.
People have tried to. So.
And it's easy to weaponize now. I can't remember
yeah.
why.
Yeah.
So if the NSA is watching this, believe me, I really don't remember how to weaponize it.
Speaking of NSA, where did you learn the configuration of the labs that you describe? I mean, you go into the labs in detail. Was that also your source?
Oh, that
help?
Was my childhood experience.
Okay.
We used to go into my dad's lab. We played around with his stuff. And he had his first two graduate students. One was from the Philippines, and one was a second-generation Japanese-American who would make snacks for us and put them in the lab refrigerator. So it's like all the chocolate cake of my childhood tasted like benzene. And I still am hoping that Vogue Chocolates will come up with the benzene.
Benzene variety. Benzene mint.
Right.
Right, right. Benzene mint. Okay. A little self-reflection, if you can, or if you want to. You are known for your social conscience, whether it's issues of discrimination, inequality, powerful interests who exploit the powerlessness of other people. When did that develop? Were you aware of that as a child, or did it happen as you became more mature?
Well, I have to say, you know, my grandparents were immigrants from Eastern Europe, they were among the few survivors of their families from the Shoah, the Holocaust. And so we were very aware of that. We were very aware growing up of what happens when you let hate and narcissistic rage take, I mean, that wasn't the language of my childhood, but I don't think there was a time that we didn't, I have four brothers, so we didn't know that. I just had someone just sent me a blog. My older brother converted to Catholicism. He's a Dominican priest, and he's in New York City right now. And he, a Dominican Republic, man from the Dominican Republic who works for them, was arrested in the middle of the night as he was coming to work, just taken off a subway. He has a green card, you know, but ICE agents are just randomly targeting. It's kind of like the Cossacks are roaming the streets. And my brother leapt up and went to Senator Gillibrand and got her to bring him to the head of ICE in New York City. And so I think that there's just a way, and I was so moved when I read what he was doing because he never talked about it. So I think there's just a way in which we all knew that we had an obligation to act when we could. I don't think I'm nearly as brave as I wish I was.
Oh, I think you are.
Well,
you talk out, you talk about issues and you point things up when you see them. And I always say that you wear your courage on your sleeve. You wear your feelings and your courage on your sleeve.
That's very generous.
Well, it's true. Are you involved with anything on an organized basis right now, or?
The issue that I just can't walk away from is reproductive rights, and so I'm active with Planned Parenthood on that. I'm running a Facebook page with a couple of other women called Sara Paretsky and Friends Act for Justice, and it's one of the many places that people can go to get some ideas on how to act, what to do. We rely on the indivisible, the wall of us, and then readers write in with really good suggestions on actions to do. And you know, we know it's going to be a very long haul to pull America back from this kind of...
The abyss.
The abyss. So the fact that people get tired and just aren't up to the job doesn't matter, because the job is going to be there for a long time. And so we encourage people to wax and wane, do take time off when you can, and step up when you can. And hopefully there are enough of us that...
You also have an ability to incorporate some of those issues into your stories, into your VI books.
That is more because it's what's on my mind. It's not that I set out... I don't want to write like a Soviet social realist, you know, like Ivan on the tractor 24 hours a day bringing in the potato harvest against all odds while the kulaks are slacking off and deserve to be starved to death. It's more that these things are just on my mind. Sometimes I feel like a parody, like out of Uncle Tom's Cabin, Little Eva. These things, I feel them here, Papa, Little Eva says.
Well, I know you were talking to Kent at a conference, and he had just been on this show, Kent Kruger, and we were talking about the fact that mystery novels are a great platform for social issues, perhaps more than any other genre, and that they are, in some ways, the muckraking books of our time.
I agree, absolutely. And it's because they're the natural place for this. It's where law, justice, society, all those issues come together. I really enjoy snarking Saul Bellow, which I guess is bad of me because he's dead and can't fight
can't
back.
Can't stick up for himself, right?
Although he's got plenty of supporters to do it for him. But, you know, Humboldt's Gift, which is partly about crime on the South Side, and he definitely was on a different part of the political spectrum than I am. He just couldn't get his hands dirty writing a crime novel, and so it's just the most unreadable mishmash of ranting about crime on the South Side, and then suddenly we're off in Eastern Europe talking to some philosopher on his deathbed.
Right.
And if you can't get your hands dirty, don't try to write about dirt, because you're just going to be floating above it.
Which brings the question, why crime fiction? When I know you were working in an insurance company when you wrote Indemnity. Why crime fiction?
Oh, it's just what I always read.
Okay.
And so I'm going to be 70 and... 6 weeks, help. So I would say it's only in the last 10 years that I've been trying to catch up on ordinary fiction. It's just what I read forever. And now, of course, I'm going back to it because it calms me down.
Because justice prevails at the end?
Yeah,
usually?
Or, you know, it's a world that I know, and I'm just not ready for books like The Sympathizer, brilliant though it is.
Yeah. Speaking of writing, what comes most easily to you? Is it dialogue? Is it narrative?
I would say dialogue comes most easily, but all writing is easy for me when I know what I'm doing. I always say I never have writer's block. I have thinker's block.
That's a good way to put it.
And I sometimes think that you can smell the burning rubber all over the South Side when I'm stuck and trying to pull ideas into my head.
What's the hardest thing for you? Just getting the plot down or?
The plot is hard. I always know what the crime is when I've started a book.
Right.
But the story that you tell to bring the crime to sort of sleight of hand fool the reader, that's what I have the hardest time with. And so coming up with the characters who are just the right distance from the crime. If they're too close, you don't have a story. And if they're too far, your story meanders.
I was sure you were going to pull a reverse with the police officer, Everard.
Uh-huh.
Everard. But he turned out to be a nice guy.
Yes, I don't think I'm a subtle enough writer to do that. I often think about that with characters, that they look like good guys and they should be bad guys, or they look like bad guys and they turn out to be good guys. But I just, I don't know.
Well, my impression is that your prose is very disciplined, that it's very much tied to the story or the inner thoughts of VI, but every once in a while you sneak in a very lyrical, almost a poetic phrase or sentence. Is that just kind of, is that conscious or is it just the way you write?
Thank you. That's a really nice compliment, and I like that way of thinking about it, because I wrote two books that weren't in my series, one actually set in Kansas.
Bleeding Kansas.
Right. And there, I would say that my inclination is maybe more lyrical, but that for the VI novels, that would be wrong in every way to have that be the prose style.
Yeah, no, it's very disciplined, and it, you know, every sentence pretty much advances the story or VI's frame of mind. Yeah, more disciplined than mine, for sure.
No, I think that's, no.
But anyway.
No self-abuse allowed on this show.
Okay, here's something. You write chapter titles. Uh-huh. I have never written chapter titles. I wouldn't know the first thing about doing them. Why are they important to you?
They started out, my husband always used to be my first reader, and he liked chapter titles, and so he would help me create them. And then there was a wonderful man who was Don Sandstrom. I don't know if ever met him.
I did.
He was a great fan, mystery fan. He was a professional, he was a career Army man. And when he retired from the Army, he was a longtime mystery lover. He talked about, he grew up in poverty, which is why he joined the Army, and that was how he made a living. But his mother was a single mom, and it was one of those stories where they went to the library every Saturday. And then she was one of the first subscribers to the Doubleday Crime Club, and she gave him the big sleep when he shipped out to Europe during the Second World War. And after that, she would send him the Crime Club selections as he fought his way around Europe and, thank goodness, came home safely. So when he retired from the Army, he devoted the remainder of his life to fanzines, blogs of yesteryear, the pre-internet era, and he was a huge supporter of mine and defender of mine. When I helped get Sisters in Crime going, I personally came in for enormous amounts of abuse.
Really?
Oh my God, yes.
Well, I guess I wasn't around then. What?
It was threatening to people like Otto Penzler, for instance, who would attack us and then there were quite a few attacks on us that said basically we were advocating censorship, we wanted to get men's books off the shelves, and so on and so on and so on.
Jeez.
And Don was like, he got on his horse and he galloped into my to my defense in his fanzines. And great guy. Great
and now
guy.
We are 3,500 strong, so
yeah.
There.
But he also loved the chapter titles, and so it's kind of every book now my husband isn't able to to deal with it anymore, but Don, it's kind of in memory of Don and in just my love for him that I keep them going.
I think they're great. I mean, some are real winners and some of them are
a little
phrases.
Quirkier.
A little, yeah. I think they can't all be wonderful.
A lot of Dylan songs get into these chapter titles.
Who's your favorite character in Fallout besides VI or Bernie or...
Well, I do love, I love all of these old women, some of whom are dead, and this is bad, I cannot remember their names. Doris McKinnon. I knew this was going to be on the test, and I didn't study.
Oh, it's okay. I do that all the time.
But the elderly African-American woman.
Evelyn, right?
No, not Emerald Faring, the actress, but
the
church woman. Elle Albritton.
Albritton, right.
That'll teach me to come up with such odd names for people.
You liked her.
I did. I really enjoyed writing about her. And I think that I always, in all of my books, when there's an older woman, and this kind of character crops up
more than once in my novels, an older woman who, the dynamic between VI and the older woman is something that I always enjoy.
She has the wisdom that VI needs.
But she's not, you know, it's not like a motherly figure. There's a certain amount of caustic response there. Like, you think you know everything, young lady, but you've still got a ways right. to travel.
Speaking of caustic, there was a fair amount of snark by VI in this story. You started out, okay, I'm not going to be snarky. VI's not going to be snarky. And then as the obstacles piled up and
right.
she just couldn't help herself.
I know. This lack of impulse control is a constant problem for both of us.
Well, it was funny. Okay, I know we're kind of running out of time, but I do want to ask you, you have been nominated for a slew of awards. You've been recognized by the UK. You've been recognized in other countries. Is there a special award or recognition that you prize more than the others?
I did love getting the Cartier Diamond Dagger from the British Crime Writers Association. And when you get it, there's a dagger like Excalibur, the sword of King Arthur, in a silver book, and your name is inscribed in the silver book, and then there's this gold dagger that has jewels in the handle, and you get a teeny tiny one. And I went to the vault in Bond Street in London, where they pulled it out, and I have a photo on my website of me in the vault.
Oh, it stays in London.
Yeah, it stays in London.
Well, I didn't know that.
In the bylaws are that the winner gets to keep it for the year of their award, but the thought of transporting that across the Atlantic safely, the dagger, you don't want that in your carry-on luggage. You know it'll be confiscated from you if you have this dagger in your... I mean, you can't put it in your checked luggage. It'll evaporate.
Right. So you left it.
But when I'm in London, if I'm doing something special, then they'll bring it out and use it as the centerpiece for a dinner or something. And they have a guard who stands there very solemnly. I love the last time we did it for Marjorie Allingham's centenary lunch. And this guard, I was the youngest person in the room by far. And he hovered near it because he knew that we old ladies could put on our roller skates and he wouldn't even let us give him a sandwich. He knew that was a ruse to take his attention away from the dagger.
That's funny. Do you want to write more standalones, more non-mysteries? Or have you?
I think right now my own private life is in a fair amount of tumult, and so I'm having a hard time getting to that interior space where your real creativity comes from. So right now, VI is kind of like she's like my best friend. She keeps me going. When an idea for another standalone comes to me, I hope I'll have the guts to write it. Right now, I can't get a contract for anything but VI. But right now, I'm not thinking of anything but VI.
Okay, that's fair. Of all the books that you've written, which is personally most satisfying? Excluding Fallout, which we know is her baby, and this is the one that everyone should buy. But which is the other? Which one?
Critical Mass was two books ago in the series, and
I read that.
And thank you. My husband, it's another very complicated storyline, but my husband was a protege of Enrico Fermi's, and who brought him to the University of Chicago. And for all the years, we've been together for 46 years now, that I've known him, I had wanted to write a book that was set in that world.
The early years of before it was called the Manhattan Project.
Right. Yeah. But I never could come up with a storyline, and I really almost let it go too long when the right story just suddenly came to me. And so even though in some ways it's a very convoluted and complicated story, a lot of it's really personal to me. I was able to use Lottie Herschel to create a connection to my own European family history. I was able to use K. characters and people that I'd met through my husband to connect to the history of women in physics and to connect to to the, I mean, forget about, if you can, for one moment, the hideous possibility of if it's still on.
Yeah, it is.
Of nuclear war. But one of the most exciting quests in human history was the quest for what lay at the heart of the atom. And so doing that reading and sort of getting on that horse and galloping around was, it was pretty exciting.
Yeah, I'm sure. I read it very carefully because I was writing a story set at the same time. In fact, we've overlapped a couple of times.
Right.
When you were doing the 60s, Martin Luther King.
And you wrote that brilliant book set really in the riots.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, I'm not remembering the
set
time.
Set the Night on Fire.
Set the Night on
but
Fire.
That
is really...
One last question. Why'd you bring Pepe the dog along in this story? I have a feeling I know, but that it was an elegy for your Golden?
No, I don't know why I brought Pepe the dog along, but then I realized that it's like that thing with Chekhov, if there's a gun, it has to be used. So Pepe had to have a role.
That's
and so part of how I then was able to envision the chase scene in the end was because Pepe needed to have a role.
Pepe did. Pepe was the hero too.
Yes.
The librarian and Pepe. For those of you who don't know, I don't think I'm giving any spoilers. Pepe is VI's golden retriever and one of the dogs that she and Mr. Contreras take care of. And VI took her along when she went to Kansas. Okay, well, I think we are now running out of time. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Libby,
this was really fun.
Reading so carefully and asking such great questions.
Oh, well, I wish we had another half hour to go, but we have been talking again about Fallout by Sara Paretsky, which is published by William Morrow. And I want to thank William Morrow for sending all these books, and thanks Sara for coming in at the start of what I know is going to be an exhausting tour for you, but I'm sure it will be very, very successful. And as for us, we have a very full April.